It's rare that a film comes along that splits the movie community so much. A film that some laud as a masterpiece, and others say is actually the worst film they've ever seen. This year, Only God Forgives is that movie. As I've done in the past with Prometheus, Drive, and A Good Day to Die Hard, I'm going to delve in depth into this film and give my thoughts on its many meanings and underlying metaphors. So sit back, grab some popcorn, and let's get nerdy about Only God Forgives. But please keep in mind two things. One, this review features many spoilers, so please check out my spoiler-free review first if you don't wish to know the details of the film. And two, this is just my interpretation. There are a few factual thoughts about this film out there. You really can only make up your own ideas. So keep that in mind as you watch this. The movie opens with just a taste of the incredible cinematography that Larry Smith has to offer. Its opening shots are so beautifully crafted, it pains me to know that the Academy will likely not consider this film for best cinematography due to its lurid content. We learn quickly that Julian, played by Ryan Gosling, manages a Thai boxing club, and through a series of shots, it becomes clear that it's really just a front for drugs. We're introduced to Billy, Julian's brother, who says, "Time to meet the devil," before going out to feed his lewd, psychopathic urges. Take note of where Gosling stands in this scene, staring at his brother with a look of contempt. The next few scenes are fairly straightforward. Billy attacks some women, and we learn that he eventually kills one of them. The cops call in a retired officer named Chang to exact some form of vengeance on the situation. We also get our first shot of Julian staring at his hands, beneath a fighter's statue. Hands are a humongous thing in this movie. We'll talk more about that soon. Upon making eye contact with Chang, Billy's expression reveals something much greater than a human has entered the room. You can tell he knows Chang isn't normal. In fact, most people in this film look at Chang as if he's not normal in some way. So let's just get this out of the way. Chang is God. I mean, it's not even my interpretation. Nicholas Winding Refn has flat out said that in interviews. He even directed the actor before shooting by whispering in his ear, "You are God." This explains many things in the film. Why he draws a sword from nowhere. Why he's virtually untouchable. And why he exacts vengeful justice on sinners, as well as forgiveness. Chang has the murdered girl's father brought in, and rather than comforting or consoling him, he asks him how he could let his daughter be a prostitute. How could he let this happen, he asks. He then gives the father a choice. Do what you want, he says. He gives the father free will to choose what to do with his daughter's killer. The father kills Billy. After seeing the remains of the father's rampage, Chang brings the father outside and asks him to explain himself. The father begs for forgiveness. Chang wants to know what he is sorry for. It's clear that Chang is trying to explain to the father that his real sin was letting his daughters work as prostitutes. He pulls out a sword, seemingly from nowhere, and cuts off the father's arm, saying that this is so you'll never forget them, in reference to his three living daughters. Next, we meet Mai, and we get a rather interesting scene where she touches herself as Julian remains tied up, while also entering a sort of dreamlike vision. Many have speculated that Julian's seeming inability to have normal sexual encounters with women stems from an awkward and possibly forced incest with his mother. We'll talk more about that later. As Mai starts to do the deed, Julian doesn't even look like he's enjoying it. He actually looks remorseful about the whole ordeal. Then we cross-dissolve into a shot of Julian, panning in on him, and we enter an interesting vision he seems to be having. We see a shot of an arm in the darkness. Suddenly, Julian is no longer tied up. He begins roaming the halls, approaching a dark door, reaching into it. Chang appears in the darkness, chopping off Julian's arm, much like he did to the father's. Mai finishes what she was doing. Chang then appears out of the darkness and Julian is back in his chair, appearing as if he's just had a profound revelation. Their session is interrupted when Julian's business associate informs him that his brother's been killed. Julian's reaction isn't exactly filled with tears and sorrow. In the next scene, we get the first of many karaoke songs sung by Chang. This is probably my least favorite aspect of the film. It's definitely my least favorite aspect. Nicholas Winding Refn has stated that the Thai people view this activity as almost a religious practice. Thus, he felt the inclusion of it in the film was important. Take note that Chang tends to sing whenever he's just exacted vengeance on someone. Next, we meet Julian's mother, Crystal. This scene quickly makes clear that you don't want to be on the bad side of this woman. Now, many have speculated that Crystal represents the devil. I don't know if I buy into this. I think it's just easy to assume when a movie features a character that represents God, that logically there would be a devil as well. It's true that she is always the evil voice in Julian's ear, telling him what to do and when, belittling him, insulting him. But to say that she flat out represents the devil, I think is taking a bit of a leap. Who knows, I could be wrong. As I said, all of this is just my interpretation, nothing factual here. In the next scene, we see that Julian and his associates have tracked down the father who killed Billy. He's now missing an arm, and he begins to tell his story to Julian, who eventually shows him mercy, letting him go. When the father speaks, the audio fades out. We see Julian's face as if he's acknowledging something profound. When the father points to his arm, Julian seems to understand something. It's like he's made a tiny connection in his head, possibly relating to the dreamlike vision he had earlier. We even get a shot of Chang's sword in the darkness again. It's almost like Julian is starting to understand the significance of what took place, being forgiven of one's sins, but being burdened by a constant reminder of them. Refn makes the choice to have significant moments told mostly through visuals and an incredible score by Cliff Martinez. We then get a look at Chang's home life. It's peaceful. He takes care of his daughter. He seems to be a good man. He stares out his window watching over the surroundings. We then see Julian's hands again as he watches them in the sink. But upon looking down at them, he suddenly has blood all over his hands. Now we get another dreamlike vision in which Gosling roams the halls, interspliced with shots of Chang. He approaches the dark door again, this time fearful. He eventually backs away in dread. This is when Julian meets up with his mother. It's incredibly obvious throughout this scene that Julian's relationship with her is just not normal. She's upset that Julian didn't kill the man who killed her son. She doesn't seem to care that Billy raped and killed a little girl. She's pretty much the worst mother you could have. The scene ends with a very telling shot of Crystal caressing Julian's arm. That doesn't look like the normal type of motherly love, if you ask me. I mean, she basically fondles his ass as soon as she sees him. This is just one of the reasons that Julian is so tormented. The other is explained later. She says she'll take care of the blankety blank blank man who killed her son, that it's just too much for Julian to handle. Julian was jealous of his brother. His mother clearly loved Billy more than Julian. Plus, as we'll learn later, Julian had been involved with a pretty messy family situation that could have easily screwed him and his brother up even more. We'll talk more about that soon. It's quickly summed up that Crystal hires someone to kill the father who killed her son, but she learns of Chang's involvement as well and sets out to kill him too. Now Julian is back at the club. Julian is wearing a black shirt as he watches Mai. More shots of his hands. I believe now that he imagines himself approaching Mai due to his shirt color changing to white. In his fantasy, he begins to get a little nasty with Mai, who is now wearing a different dress as well, putting his hands towards her. I believe he yearns to have a normal relationship with a woman, but due to his strange upbringing with his mother, he can't. He imagines things, fantasizes, watches. He imagines Mai holding his hands, comforting him. Don't worry, I'll explain the hands thing soon. In the middle of his fantasy, an image of his mother is inserted, his eyes open. I believe he can't get over occurrences that happened with his mother. This enrages him and causes him to lead an abnormal life. Two laughing men snap him out of his trance, at least I think that's what happens, and Julian doesn't like this. He attacks them both out of rage, dragging one of them across the floor. Now this scene looks like it's leading to something, but it abruptly ends, which bothered me. Perhaps this was something he imagined as well, but I don't think so. We're left wondering what happens. Next, the cops visit Julian, questioning him about the death of the girl's father. Julian sees Chang now, and this time, it doesn't seem to be a prophetic vision. You can tell Julian is intimidated by him. Chang says Julian isn't the one they're looking for. Julian then decides to follow Chang. I mean, hey, if you were seeing visions of someone who eventually showed up, you'd follow him too, wouldn't you? But the godlike Chang disappears. Next, we get a montage showing Chang practicing with his sword, his instrument of justice, and Crystal planning his eventual death. Julian then approaches Mai and asks her to pretend to be his girlfriend so she can meet his mother. I am convinced that Julian wants to show his mother that he has a girl in his life besides her. And the following scene at dinner tells us why. His mother insults virtually everything about him, right down to the size of his hoo-ha when compared to his brothers, furthering my belief that Crystal had an abnormal sexual relationship with her sons. In the next scene, Julian lashes out against Mai when she mentions his mother. He screams at her in one of the only true outbursts he has in the film. It's clear that any mention of his mother at this point is not something he wants to hear. He almost immediately regrets this outburst. It's very apparent that his childhood with his mother has ruined his life. Next, we see the planned assault on Chang and the subsequent carrying out of that plan, in which the untouchable Chang chases down the one killer who gets away, apprehending him. The shots leading up to this show that Chang expected that something was coming. Throughout this scene, everyone dies except Chang and his guardian angels, the other cops. Chang even knows exactly where the man will be, circling around, finding him with ease. He's led to the man who planned the attack, and upon seeing that the man is willing to accept his fate, but only wishes his boy be protected, spares him. He once again draws his sword, seemingly from nowhere, and exacts justice on the remaining killer. He spares the man and his child. Now, once again at a karaoke bar, Chang confronts the other man involved, and in a scene I personally felt went too far, blinds the man and stabs his ears because he refuses to see or listen, he says. He never appears to be enjoying this, only dealing justice. It was really Refn that I felt was enjoying the violence a little too much, fetishizing it, which he's publicly admitted to. Chang, having once again dealt justice, goes to sing some karaoke again, clearly a religious experience for him. I get it. It just got tedious after a while for me. This time, however, Julian is at the bar, apparently having tracked down Chang. It seems to me that Chang is staring at Julian while he sings. For reasons I'm unsure of, Julian seems extremely affected by this. When Julian wants to challenge Chang, one of his cops asks him, "Do you know who he is?" The way he says it, it's like Julian and everyone acknowledges that Chang is more than human, that Julian literally wants to fight God, which Nicholas Winding Refn has said was a huge inspiration to him while he wrote this movie, the idea of a man who wanted to fight God. So I'm actually under the impression that these people acknowledge who Chang actually is. Now we get the big fight scene, in which Julian lands not one single punch, not even one. Chang is completely untouchable in every way. During this fight scene, we're shown the statue that Julian stood before earlier, clenching his fists. It's clear that Julian wants to be able to fight, as he sort of imitated the stance of that statue, but he's just not up to par with someone like, say, God. In the next scene, Crystal now stands before a broken Julian in the same place Julian stared at his brother earlier. She says when she was pregnant with Julian, she felt that it was an odd pregnancy, as if Julian wanted her to terminate. She also begs him to protect her from Chang. She promises that she can be a good mother to him again, and mentions something about Julian's father. She says, "I know after your father, I'd never ask you again." Julian is a little hopeful now. He clearly yearns for the approval of his mother. This drives Julian to kill the guard at Chang's house and break inside with his associate, who seems to think everyone must die, including the child. Julian doesn't like this. Meanwhile, Chang and his guardian angels pay a visit to Crystal, where we learn the most important piece of Julian's past. He killed his own father with his bare hands, she says. This makes a lot more of the movie clearer to me. I believe when Julian stares at his hands, as he does so often, and gives his hands to Mai in a fantasy so that she can rub them and comfort him, he feels a strong sense of regret for what he did to his father. Add that to his terrible upbringing with his mother, and you've got one broken man. I feel that he yearns for forgiveness for his sins, which is why he keeps having strange prophetic visions of Chang cutting his arms off, and his hands in the sink that have blood on them, so to speak. She talks more about her special relationship with Billy, and how Julian was so jealous. Essentially, I believe that Julian's youth led him to be this way. Killing his own father, the hint of incest, and having no real understanding of a normal sexual relationship would just make about anyone go a little nuts. But as seen in the next scene, where Julian saves the little girl from death, it's clear he still has a moral center and longs for forgiveness for his sins. The things his mother is saying to the cops makes it clear she really doesn't want a life with her son anymore. I mean, hell, she just told the cops her son's a murderer. This leads me to believe that it is possible that she stands for the devil, but I'm not sure on that one. She's manipulative, evil, and the voice in Julian's ear constantly encouraging him to do wrong. But like I said, it's not entirely sure to me. This is when Chang decides to enter the room. Once it's clear how horrible of a mother Crystal really is, it's almost like he was listening, willing to give her one last chance, but he knows she isn't who she says she is. He removes his magical sword and kills her, exacting justice once again. Julian then takes one of Chang's swords and finds his dead mother in her room, leading to one of the most confusing scenes in the movie. He stabs the body with the sword and reaches inside, feeling around. The first time I saw this, I really didn't like or understand this scene. Having seen the film 3 times now, I honestly am still confused by it. There are multiple theories floating around out there. According to the IMDb trivia page under the spoiler section, quote, "It was Ryan Gosling's idea to open the stomach of Julian's dead mother. He had it after director Nicholas Winding Refn asked him if he'd rather smile or cry after Julian's mom's death. He replied that he'd open her uterus to see what's inside," end quote. If that really is the reason, then indeed Julian is a very damaged boy. Some have speculated that this was a metaphor for crawling back into the womb. Some have thought it had something to do with wanting to transfer his guilt back to his mother, as his hands are a metaphor for guilt or regret in most people's eyes. Or he's just pretty messed up. Either way, I'm not sure this scene was necessary. He seems to fantasize again, showing up in the bar, seeing Mai, and seeing Chang there once again, looking oddly warm and kind of inviting. Immediately, we see Julian raising his hands in a completely different location, putting his guilt and regret out in front of Chang. Finally, we get the full arc of the vision Julian had, again seeing the shot of Chang raising his sword in the darkness. Chang accepts this sacrifice and forgives him by removing Julian's arms. Thus the title, Only God Forgives. So in a way, this is actually a happy ending for Julian. He's accepted his punishment and moved on from his past. He can now try to lead a better life. At least, this is my interpretation of the film. It ends with Chang again singing karaoke, having just exacted justice. Now apparently, the original script featured another scene of an armless Julian being fed pudding by Mai. I really wish this scene remained in the film. It would have helped solidify that Julian was learning to have a normal relationship with a woman, moving on from his past life. I think it would have justified more of the violence in the eyes of the film's many critics. I'll be honest, watching the film a few more times did heighten my appreciation for it much more. The karaoke still annoys me, I still think the torture scene goes too far, and I'm still unsure about the scene where Julian cuts open his mother. But I think in time, away from the hype, this film will gain more respect. It's not your typical film at all, and many people were disappointed by its odd structure, but I truly have never seen a film like it, which is a huge compliment. When Refn garnered much attention with Drive, everyone started watching him. The critics would be harsher, the audience more judgmental. But having made films like Valhalla Rising previously, in which the main hero literally didn't speak one single word, Refn has certainly treaded ground like Only God Forgives before. With time, this movie will find its audience. I hope you liked my interpretation of Only God Forgives, and that it helped shine some light on the film for those who had a tough time understanding it. As always guys, thanks very much for watching, and if you like this, you can click right here and get Stuckmanized.
Only God Forgives is the new film from the director everybody loves to hate, Nicholas Winding Refn. I personally am a huge fan of Refn, not only as a filmmaker, but as a person and an artist, so Only God Forgives was, naturally, my most anticipated movie of 2013. But the reviews it kept getting were mostly just awful, and I thought that maybe he simply missed the mark with Only God Forgives. Most of the complaints I saw had to do with plot, character development, storyline, and simply the way Refn told the story. I found this intriguing, so what I decided to do before seeing the film was to try to find every interview I could with Refn talking about the film, hoping that I really could understand what he was going for in his head while making Only God Forgives. Seeing the film four times now, plus knowing all of what Refn said in his interviews and me mixing it up in my head, I came up with what I believe to be the essence of the film and all it is trying to be, and I wanted to share that with all of you while urging you to take not one, but multiple looks at the film following this video. Everyone can agree that this is a beautiful work of art, meticulously crafted with extreme precision, but I believe the whole film to be nothing short of spectacular in every aspect, a film that I like to call a masterpiece. Here is something that Nicholas Winding Refn said in a Cannes Film Festival interview.
You know, when people either love you or hate you, they actually hate you and love you for the same reasons. And then you know you've penetrated the audience and you have touched them and you have sparkled something in them that flows through their system that either they consume and they take with them and love, or they hate it and destroy it, destroys them, and they're angry at me for doing that. And all I can say is thank you very much. There'll be another one. You know, it's what art is supposed to do. There's, you know, we have this idea that we live in a society where there's a perfect scenario of art. Art is like a, it's like almost like a manual. If you do this, this, and this, you achieve that. But that's the chief enemy of creativity, is being safe. It's having good taste. It's having all those things, because art is expression of emotions, and it has to grab you in a poetic, beautiful, gentle way, as well as a violent, aggressive, and frustrating way.
Now, I found this to be not only extremely truthful, but inspiring. Only God Forgives seems to deliberately go against almost all that we know to be generally true in film. Here we do not have a main character who's a badass and can kick ass and get with any girl. In fact, we don't really even have a main character in the film. What we have is a seemingly hopeless guy stuck on this main character mantle who seems lost and out of place at all times. The problem that not only average moviegoers, but even intellectual audiences face, is this frame of mind that they have going into a film. The frame of mind they have is not their fault. It's in fact the lack of people like Refn in the movie industry that is the reason. Now, naturally, I'll be talking about everything in the film, so if you haven't watched the film, please do not watch this video yet. Watch the movie, maybe you want to give it some time to sit first, but then return to this video. So, that's it, final warning. Now let's get started. This is what Refn said in regards to where the film's premise came from. He said, "I had an idea to do a movie about a man who believes he's God versus a man who wants to fight him." He then goes on to say that was a little broad and needed to be scaled down to a more accessible level. Now, broad? Sure, definitely. But I can't say that he scaled down the idea for the story in many ways. Here's why. It's important for me to get this out of the way as soon as possible. So, I strongly believe that Chang, the cop played exceptionally well by this man right here, does not represent God. He is God. And you could go even more specific and get biblical and name him the God of Vengeance. But regardless, I do not think this is simply a man who believes he's God, and I will explain myself throughout this video. Right off the bat, when the film opens, we see Julian, a man who runs a Thai sparring club that is basically used as a cover-up for his drug business. The incident that sets the story in motion is Julian's brother Billy murdering a 16-year-old prostitute. Before going out, prior to this incident, Billy says to Julian, "Time to meet the devil." The simple explanation to this is that Billy must meet his offensive, aggressive, and disgusting needs by causing mayhem and looking to have sex with an underage girl. But now I think that maybe Billy was simply committing suicide. He did go out in hopes to beat women, rape a young girl, and brutally murder her, and he didn't even attempt to escape. I mean, the fact that he owns a boxing club would make me think that he could have at least fought back a little bit against the father of the girl when he beats him to death. But anyway, back to the plot. We see the girl lying dead in a puddle of blood, and Chang is summoned to act some sort of vengeance on Billy. Note that Chang walks to the scene of the crime, and a police car is already there. Also, the way Billy turns around to see Chang, Billy knows that this is no ordinary man. So Chang arrives at the scene of the murder and asks the father of the girl, "How could you do it? How could you let this happen?" The father says reasonably, "I didn't do anything." Makes sense, right? So to that, Chang gives the dead girl's father the opportunity to do as he wishes to Billy. So the father kills Billy, bashes his head in using a block of wood he held in his right arm. Meanwhile, Chang stands outside in the rain, and although he is not watching the incident, you can tell he knows exactly what is happening. It is here that we get our first glimpse of Chang as a godlike figure. While standing in the rain, an older man walks up the stairs to him, a way of showing Chang's dominance by having him in a higher position. This man is holding a tray and a drink on it. Chang accepts the drink from the man, who bows down to Chang and walks off. Things like this will come up throughout the film, so keep that in mind. So immediately following the beating, we cut to the father in the middle of a deserted area on his knees in a helpless position with Chang's men in the surrounding area. The father is scared and confused, as anyone would be in that situation. He blubbers, "I'm sorry, my apologies, please don't kill me." The father believes Chang has brought him out there because of what he did to Billy. He can't believe it. But Chang, however, is not punishing him for that. He is punishing him for letting his daughters become prostitutes. And so he never forgets his three other daughters. Chang slices the lower half of the father's right arm off. Now I want to focus on Chang and his interaction with Julian, played by Ryan Gosling. Julian sees Chang two or three times through visions without ever even meeting him in real life. The first time he sees Chang happens during one of the most amazing and purposely convoluted scenes in the film, involving a vision or dream sequence and reality, as they cut back and forth between each other and clash confusingly. Here's what happens. Julian is sitting down in a chair when a beautiful woman named Mai walks in. Mai walks towards him and ties his hands to the arms of the chair. Now, usually when someone ties their partner down in a sexual act, the free person will perform something pleasurable on the tied-down partner. But in this case, she sits down on the bed in front of him and begins to masturbate, showing us that Julian clearly has trouble finding a woman in his life, but more on that later. He definitely does not have a look of pleasure or enjoyment on his face. He almost has the look of a small child, or a look of sadness, a longing look for this thing that he can't have, a woman or a relationship in his life. Suddenly, we see Julian notice a figure in a doorway down some hall. Julian's hands aren't tied down anymore. Now, I believe it's up to the viewer whether you think that Mai on the bed was one of Julian's visions or not, but currently Mai is still standing at the door just how she entered. But now the vision continues. Julian is suddenly in the hallway, walking towards the door where some man looms in the darkness. Julian reaches the door and tentatively holds his arm out through the doorway. We then see Chang viciously slice off the lower half of his arm, representing the climax of that vision, and milliseconds after that exact moment, we cut to Mai climaxing from Julian's first vision, or reality, however you want to look at it. It is then that Gordon, played by Gordon Brown, a friend from the fighting club, comes in and tells Julian about the death of Billy. So, we know that one, Chang cuts off arms. That is significant. He cuts off the father's arm because he'd done wrong. Julian's arm gets cut off in his vision, but he hasn't really connected the dots yet, and we as an audience don't exactly know why his arm got cut off. But what we do understand is that this is an act that Chang takes on people in order to punish them. We also learn something else about Chang. He drew the sword from behind his back, yet we know that there was in fact nothing on his back, no sword and no holster to carry it. How do we know? This happens numerous times in the film, and it's no continuity mistake. Revan gives us a clear view of Chang's blankly clothed backside before every draw of his sword. Now, if that doesn't prove that Chang is God, the fact that he can magically generate swords to draw behind his back, then I guess I have some more evidence later on that I'll get to. After the arms come off, we have our first karaoke scene, where Chang's men are watching Chang sing. Keep that in mind, as it is very important. Also, Julian's mother, Crystal, arrives in glorious bitchy fashion, of course. Now, the karaoke is very, very, very important to the film, and quite fascinating, in fact, as far as Thai culture goes, but I must get to that later, because I want to stick with the Julian Chang and the father's story for a little more here. Now we see Julian walking into a small hay barn where we find two of his friends from the fighting club, one of them being Gordon, and the father of the prostitute, crouched in the corner, wondering what the hell is going on. Julian asks the father why he killed his brother. Before the father responds, the soundtrack fades in, beautifully, by the way, and although we don't know exactly what the father's response is, we know that he is describing what happened with him, Billy, and Chang. While he is frantically telling the story, he points to what is left of his right arm, and Julian relives the vision in his mind of his own arm getting chopped off, in roughly the exact same place, and knows that this man who sliced off the father's arm is the same man he saw in his vision. Directly after this, we see Chang come home to a little girl who we believe to be his daughter, and her sitter. He kneels down next to the girl we assume is his daughter, and she says, "We have to leave him alone now," while both are looking down at a teddy bear she is holding. Chang says, "Then how do we make sure he doesn't cause trouble again?" The daughter replies, "By talking nicely to each other." Now I know this is significant. I've watched too many Nicholas Winding Refn films to just pass something like this by. But I gotta be honest, I really don't know what she's referring to here. It seems that they are talking about the stuffed animal in her lap, and a scenario that she created for it. But I just know it has to relate to the story in some way, but it's not very clear. If anyone thinks they have it, let me know below. So a little break from the storyline here. You may be wondering, how can Julian have a vision of a man that he's never met before? And how does he connect the dots of his vision of losing his arm and the father's arm getting chopped off? And why is Julian's mom so cruel? And how does Chang generate swords on his back? And there's no effing way that Chang is God. Now, I have an answer. In fact, I don't. Nicholas Winding Refn does. he said in an interview, one of the most important things you have to know when going into this film. Only God Forgives is a fairy tale. Yes, I know it's hard to muster this, especially when Refn has been known to make such vibrant, realistic worlds, but this is a film that you can't take realistically. If you try to look at it from a realistic standpoint, you're going to be disappointed. You are not going to fully appreciate it, and with a movie like this, you have to just let it wash over you, let it take you where you want it to take you, and really just have your own vision of the world. The fairy tale aspect rings especially true with Julian's mother, who is just horribly mean and awful and degrading, and it's true that no mother would ever say half the things she does, but Refn said it himself. He said, "I like the idea of this evil mother and her son chained to her womb." That last part is very important as well. You've seen evil moms and especially stepmoms in so many stories, and the mother, played perfectly by Kristen Scott Thomas, is brilliantly heinous and darkly comical as the biggest bitch alive, basically. Remember earlier how I said Julian is simply out of place? He was just born into the wrong family, and now let's talk about Julian for a second, and I'll give you my take on what, if much at all, is going on in this guy's head. I believe that one thing is going on in Julian's head. Only one thing is on his mind. He wants to fight God. Another short vision occurs with Julian when we see him washing his hands. Everything seems fine until the faucet starts to run blood, and Julian looks up to see Chang staring at him. Julian walks out into the hallway again, approaching the same door that Chang lurked once before. Julian again feels lured by the spirit, but this time, he seems worried and frightened to a point where he even stops, turns around, and meets his mother in one of the rooms. Now, here we have a very interesting scene with Crystal, Julian's mom, and Julian, that I sometimes question whether it really happened or not, but I'll go with the idea that it's real for now. The scene is the first scene between Julian and Crystal, and it shows us the kind of relationship Julian has with his mother. In this scene, Crystal suggestively touches Julian's butt and caresses his arm, showing that maybe the reason that Julian can't find love is because of a forced incest between him and his mother. What we know is that he feels this attachment to his mother, like this chain linking them together that he can't break. You really see the forced respect he has to show his mother. Crystal is upset that Julian didn't kill the man who killed her first son, and says that she'll take care of it. Crystal also learns that a cop was involved, gets Gordon and another friend of Julian's, Byron, played by a man named Byron, to help set up the hit on both the prostitute's father and Chang. Now Julian is back at the club with a black shirt on, looking yearningly at a woman standing behind beaded curtains, who's just basically there to have something pretty to look at in the club. Julian is suddenly up and right next to the girl, but he's wearing a white shirt, and we now see that the girl in there is Mai. In his vision, just like all of his visions, he is capable of doing something or having something that he can never have in real life. He is able to break through this barrier and reach out to Mai, well, really reach into Mai. I'll stop right there with that explanation, but he yearns for a relationship with Mai, and still at this point in the film, he has yet to make any of his visions become a reality. Also, on a bit of a side note, it's beautiful scenes like this that remind me how perfect the soundtrack by Cliff Martinez is. It adds to each of the characters' feelings and really just sucks you in and leaves you in a trance. What snaps Julian out of his vision is these two men at the other side of the club laughing at him. Julian clenches his fists and gets up and smashes a glass in the face of the man laughing at him, punches the other man in the face, and drags the man across the floor with his jaw. I believe this really happened. Some people say that, in fact, it was a dream or still part of the vision, but he was wearing a black shirt again, just like he was in what we believed to be reality earlier. The scene does awkwardly cut off, though, which, I don't know, I can't say that I wanted to see more than I needed to see more, but it would have been interesting seeing where he took that man. But in the following scene, Julian is told that the police want to see him. He learns that the father of the girl Billy murdered has been killed. And naturally, the police want to ask him some questions, as Julian would be a reasonable suspect. After the police ask him a few questions, the look on Julian's face changes. He senses Chang. He spins around to see Chang in the distance, outside of the boxing ring. All of the fighters surround him and bow down to him, another example of him being treated like a god. Chang walks towards Julian, takes one good look at him, and says, "He's not the one, for I believe he is an omniscient, all-knowing person. How else would he know by taking one small look at Julian that he's not the one who murdered the father?" Chang leaves, and like he did in the beginning of the film, walks, while the other men take the police car. As we know, Julian has finally seen the man from his visions, the one person who he's been meant to meet for a long time now, and he wants to know more, naturally. So Julian follows Chang through the streets for a long time before losing him in the crowd. But he doesn't just lose him, Chang disappears. Next, we have a scene where Julian approaches Mai, an example of him actually grasping his visions in reality, and asks her to go to dinner with him so that she can meet his mother. I believe he does this so that Crystal can see that he actually has a woman in his life besides his mom. His mom responds to this wonderfully by offending Mai to a ridiculous extent, and insulting Julian in every way possible. She brings up Billy, explaining that Julian was even jealous of the size of Billy's boomstick, if you know what I mean, calling it enormous, further suggesting that she had weird sexual relationships with both of her sons. When Julian and Mai are walking home, Mai is shocked and asks Julian, Why do you let her treat you like that? Julian then violently freaks out and says, because she's my mother. Again, showing this inseparable link between he and his mother that he hates, but must live with. He gets very irrational with Mai, but instantly regrets his actions. You can also tell that he can't stand the mention of his mother at this point. The scene that follows is the hit on Chang. This entire scene is outstanding. We see two men approach Byron, the man that Crystal told to put the hit out on Chang. Meanwhile, Chang is sitting at a restaurant with two of his men. As the men performing the hit come closer and closer to this restaurant, Chang knows exactly what is going to happen. You can see it in his eyes, and through a series of shots, we can tell that he even knows that Crystal is the one responsible for setting up the hit. So the men shoot up the restaurant, and everyone gets hit except for Chang and his two men that are there with him. Chang chases one of the men down, but instead of following him directly, runs a different path right to where he knows the man will end up. This man leads him to the man who was a supplier for the hit. But when the supplier says that he will accept the consequences as long as he spares his son, Chang spares the man and once again draws his sword, gruesomely killing the man who performed the hit. Going through the list, as Chang seems to be doing, he moves on to Byron, the man who paid the guy to perform the hit. We find him in a karaoke bar watching a woman sing. Now is an excellent time to explain the importance of karaoke in the film. Karaoke is extremely, extremely, extremely important in the film. It is something that is taken very seriously and almost religiously in Bangkok, is what I found out. People in that culture will try to get rooms in the best hotels with the best karaoke bars and just listen for hours during the night. There is even a very respectful nightlife karaoke that happens from the hours of 1 to 5 in the morning, all taken very seriously. So Refn didn't just throw the karaoke in there to be cool and different and artsy and make it look more important than it really is. In fact, he used it quite brilliantly to help the story. Remember the first karaoke song happens immediately after Julian, in his vision, and the prostitute's father loses their arms. The second karaoke song happens after Chang kills the man who performed the hit with his sword. In both cases, the karaoke is used as an act of cleansing to follow an act of violence. I also mentioned earlier that Chang's men are there watching him sing karaoke. It is very important that they are there because, one, it shows the respect and the almost worship-like admiration they have for Chang, but also because they are there to witness the act of violence, then they should be there to endure the acts of cleansing. You'll notice that when Chang and his right-hand man enters the karaoke bar to kill Byron, the cop says, "Remember, girls, no matter what happens, keep your eyes closed. And you men, take a good look." This is important because he wants the men to experience the violence and really just take it in while keeping the women apart from it. Byron is reluctant to answer any questions, and a very gruesome scene follows that is shot and executed perfectly, where Chang eventually slits Byron's eyes, telling Byron that he is not able to see the truth, so he shouldn't be able to see in general. This is one of the many examples of how the story relates to the story of Oedipus, for Oedipus himself gouges his own eyes out, for he cannot look at or be reminded of his sins. And besides the suggested sexual relationship that Julian had with his mother, there is one more very important comparison in the two stories that we will get to soon. Now, once again, Chang is singing karaoke, for he has just performed an act of violence on Byron. But this time, Julian is there, along with Mai and his mother. Chang makes a special connection with Julian as he sings. What follows is the most important part of the entire film. That line, "You want to fight," is the most important line of the film. The fight that follows between Julian and Chang is fantastic and beautiful. Julian does not land a finger on the man, but that's not because Julian is just not as good of a fighter as Chang is. I believe that Julian craves the defeat. The fight between them is what Julian has wanted this entire time. To be beaten, to be defeated, to be punished. Chang is God, so therefore he is untouchable, and he gives him a well-deserved bruise or two. Staring down at a broken and bloody Julian in the next scene, Crystal tells Julian, "When I was pregnant with you, it was strange. You were different. They wanted me to terminate, and I wouldn't. And you're right, I don't understand you, and I never will." Julian and Crystal are very emotional throughout this scene, and his mother tells him that Chang is coming for her next, and begs him to protect her. She tells him that they can get out of there, they can go home, promises she can take care of him, that she can be his mother again. This gets Julian's attention. Through a series of shots, we know that Chang is on his way to Crystal, and tells a police officer to be on guard at his house. Sometime soon after Chang has left, Julian kills the guard with one bullet and enters Chang's house without knowing that Chang has left to kill his mother. He and a fellow member of the club wait for the return of Chang, both in possession of a pistol. As they wait, Julian stops in front of the case where Chang keeps his sword. He stares at it for a while. The man asks, "Who's gonna do the kid?" To which Julian replies, "We're just here for him." But the man tells him that his mother's orders were to, quote, "kill them all," as in Chang, his daughter, and the babysitter. As they wait, Chang and the man who seems to be always with him, like some sort of guardian angel, are entering Crystal's hotel room. This scene is insanely important. Crystal explains that she had a very special relationship with Billy, being that he was her first son. Julian was so jealous, she said. It was like he was cracked or something. He had paranoid delusions about us. This further proves that indeed there were sexual relations between her and both of her sons. Oh, but there's more. She continues, "And it pains me to say this to you, as it would pain any mother. But he killed his own father with his bare hands." Ah, so two things have surfaced here. One, the ridiculous connection to the story of Oedipus, for Oedipus kills his own father. But more importantly, the fact that she clearly says that Julian killed his own father with his bare hands. This is something that I purposely put off until now, but the role that hands play in this film are almost bigger than the role that Ryan Gosling plays. There are numerous incidents of Julian using his hands in many different ways. He stares at them constantly because they are a reminder of what he did to his father. He hates himself because of this and wants to be cleaned of all his sins. When he gets mad, he is seen clenching his fists. He uses his hands sexually. He tries to wash them in the sink, but it's no use because there's still blood on his hands from murdering his father that he can't get rid of. This is why he wants to have his hands removed, and this explains the ending of the film. But we still have some things to cover before we get too ahead of ourselves. Now moving along to one of the weirdest scenes that has caused people's heads to spin. So Chang reveals himself to Crystal after listening around the corner to her conversation with his guard, basically confirming that she's just an awful mother, and kills her for it. Meanwhile, back at Chang's house, Julian's partner kills the sitter, and as he's walking towards the little girl to kill her, Julian fires three shots into the man's back, killing him and sparing the child. Before Julian leaves Chang's house, he takes the sword he was staring at earlier with him back to his mother's room. In her room, he stands there, staring at his dead mother with no obvious expression on his face, but he almost looks defeated, maybe a little sad. He then, with the sword standing over his mother, slices open her stomach. He kneels down in front of her and reaches inside of his mother. I believe that I have the best explanation for why he does this. I've heard many, many, many rumors, but I think mine is pretty damn good. I think that Julian does this because he wants to see if it's even possible that she could have birthed him. If there's really any possibility, if she really has any motherly qualities at all. Of course, we don't know. We don't know what his hand felt inside of there, or, you know, what he finds in there. I was hoping, you know, a little alien monster would come popping out, but that didn't happen. Or maybe he was reaching up to her heart to take it out, Indiana Jones style. But anyways, Julian is now back at the club, bloodied and bruised, yet looking in the same way he looked at the girl earlier in the film. This time, Chang enters the room and sits down near Julian. He looks to be in a good state of mind, though, happier than the usual grim stares he gives. I believe that he is thanking Julian for saving his daughter's life. Suddenly, Julian is looking down at his hands in a very different setting. He's in the middle of a beautiful, sparsely wooded area. Chang slowly walks up, sword in hand, and stands behind his outstretched arms, and cuts both of Julian's arms off. All Julian wanted was for God to punish, to remove him from his sins, to forgive him. And he gets exactly that. And of course, after this, we get a beautiful and haunting song sung by Chang, titled You Are My Dream, that is almost a perfect ending to the film in my eyes. And it's actually a happy ending for the character of Julian. His arms were everything that he hated about himself and his life, and now they're gone. Now, I believe this to be a masterpiece, just in the way that it is told. It's told so beautifully, just the direction, the cinematography is outstanding. It leaves you in a trance the entire time. Now, I do love films like this. This film is my cup of tea. I know that a lot of people don't like movies like this, which makes sense. People are hating on it. But I do hope that you at least appreciate the film more after my take on it. So, that is my take on Only God Forgives. I hope you liked what I had to say about it, and I hope you at least appreciate my love for the film. And hope that maybe you even take more than you thought you ever could away from the film. Now please let me know your interpretations of the film down below. Thank you so much for your time, and have a good day. Haag-mae-tur-piang-kao-chai